unaffordable small modular reactor technology would be pointless.
Affordability is the absolute driver. No developer has ever suggested to me that the cost goal was to beat coal with CCS. The target is to outperform cheap, unmitigated gas-fired power generation.
Dr. Ben Hurd is a senior consultant at Frazer-Nash, is an energy analyst and modeler, and a master's qualified sustainability professional. He recently authored the discussion paper, Small Modular Reactors in the Australian Context. He featured as one of the global voices in the film Juice, How Electricity Explains the World, and brought the world inside the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power station on a top-rated episode of 60 Minutes.
Today, I'm going to examine the potential benefits of small modular reactor technologies and the specific place they might have in the Australian energy system. I also want to look at what is hard and be realistic about the challenges that remain.
Innovating in nuclear power, it's expensive, it's uncertain, and it takes a long time. It demands long periods of investments in development without selling products. It can, and it does, fail to deliver on hopes and expectations. The first point I want to make is that there is now also a long road locked in behind SMRs that are progressing today. Real solid progress towards commercial products that will be available in salient timeframes for the investments Australia needs to make in creating its new energy system.
I'm reminded a little bit of the hype cycle, analogously electric vehicles. Now, I have wanted an electric vehicle ever since I was a child, and we've seen hype of electric cars and then deflation of expectations of electric cars. Seemingly, suddenly, we see them on our roads, we see them in car parks, and the truth of the matter is development never stopped. It was always moving along a trajectory. The trajectory was longer than it was thought to be, but products do arrive. The national electricity market of Australia is famously the largest grid in the world in terms of its geographic spread. It's famously long and skinny. It's laid out with centralized nodes of generation close to centers of demand. The current plan is for a dramatically different system.
Generation would depart those nodes and move towards nominated renewable energy zones, both distant from the grid and distant from the demand. The renewable energy zones are focused on where the renewable energy resource is good, or at least a balance between that good renewable energy resource and not being too far from demand and from the transmission network. So making this work necessitates a transmission network on an altogether different scale than we have today, a renewable supply-driven system. I think that process is going to be very difficult and has many uncertainties to it. The innovations that are occurring in nuclear are particularly supportive of our context in offering a fit-for-purpose family of technologies that work with rather than against the system that we already have and the way Australia is laid out in order to support that transition. Nuclear technologies are, broadly speaking, very low carbon. Current IPCC literature suggests 12 grams per kilowatt hour. Updated figures I've seen today is more like 4 to 6 grams per kilowatt hour. And for these advanced designs, I think the lower end of that spectrum. They provide the firm capacity, otherwise known as the very high availability. So these devices would very reliably deliver in the peak times when power is most needed. They are also, by design, a flexible base. The development of these reactors has been fully cognizant of the need to work with rather than against variable renewable energy technologies. So their flexibility will aid the integration of those low-cost variable renewables into an overall optimized zero carbon. But the flexibility and the reliability together delivers more than just variable renewable energy. It also means we can optimally utilize other new sources of demand on the power system that we're going to need for net zero that create that climate resilient, deeply decarbonized economy. So that includes storage capacity that is brought to the market, hydrogen generation infrastructure, desalination and synthetic fuel production. Can run full-time or cycle on a regular basis, providing us with the very best return on the capital investment for all of them without over-investing in any of them. The nuclear assets are very long-lived. Nuclear power plants built and commissioned today and in the near future will help us meet our 2030 targets and our 2050 targets and our 2100 targets. And that's really powerful. The siting of small modular reactors in Australia wouldn't be constrained. It's not constrained by fuel because of the density of nuclear fuel. It isn't constrained by weather. It doesn't need to go to particular renewable energy zones. So it can be put where it is most suitable based on the multi-criteria analysis. They provide the frequency control and the inertia that's needed for grid stability. This is really valuable. Almost no matter how cheap wind and solar powered electricity becomes, it's a weak pathway to the provision of high-grade heat. Small modular reactors, particularly advanced high-temperature reactors, begin that really important process of addressing that challenge in decarbonisation. Products that are now moving to commercialisation are diverse, from 1.5 megawatts to 5 megawatts to 400 megawatts. Temperatures range from 300 degrees anywhere up to about 1,000 degrees. Some refuel every couple of years. Some have a replacement after 7 years. Some are designed to go for 20 years or more without changing fuel. So SMR is a diverse family of nuclear technologies. In particular, it demonstrates something which I think is underappreciated about nuclear technologies at large, which is that nuclear technology is young. This surge of innovation and development is really reminding us of that. We've really only been through and followed one pathway of nuclear. We are still innovating very hard to get the best out of that pathway, and there are many others. So it's diverse. Now, cost effectiveness and affordability is probably the question that I'm asked most often now about small modular reactors and nuclear technology at large. And broadly speaking, we aren't there yet. Secondly, in every case that I've examined, the cost effectiveness and the affordability have been major drivers from the outset for the device itself. It is literally the whole point.
No developer has ever suggested to me that the cost goal was to beat, for example, coal with CCS. Several of them have independently told me that their target is to outperform cheap, unmitigated gas-fired power generation. So affordability is the absolute driver of this innovation.
The third important and true thing to say about this is that the evidence and the argument for affordability are, in my estimation, good. Largely delivered through design simplification, standardized repeat manufacturing, and in all cases, taking advantage of passive rather than engineered systems to deliver some of that simplification. Now, in doing that, some of the developers are stuck with known light water reactor fuel cycles, and they've innovated hard towards simplifying and optimizing that design and manufacturing with the benefits that are afforded by moving back to those smaller units, and naturally with computational power that can be brought to that challenge that wasn't available when the very, very large light water reactor paradigm was so dominant. An example is the economic simplified boiling water reactor evolving to the BWRX 300 reactor, using much of the same knowledge but achieving a really substantial simplification, which results in cascading cost savings per unit power output. Other developers, though, have gone right back to the drawing board in their selections of fuels, selections of coolant, their decisions about power density, and many other things.
But the commonality here is that every designer knows that an unaffordable reactor is pointless.
So taking the estimates and the targets from the three vendors that we profiled, we've offered a transparent and clearly referenced estimate of the levelized cost of electricity from those devices, including a 25% loading relating to owner's costs and contingencies. The results suggest that if these technologies continue to make progress towards these goals, they would likely have a substantial role in the Australian context in investment timeframes that are absolutely relevant for our energy transition. There remains space where the built and operating proof needs to be delivered, and that's very, very important. But I think there are very good reasons why Australia needs to be paying attention to these technologies. Safety is also a question I receive often, though less often than I used to, I must say. There are several important things to say about safety. Firstly, nobody wants a safe power source. We all simply expect safe power. It's a non-negotiable. Now, the existing nuclear power sector, for example, the APR 1400 reactors at Baraka in the UAE, is a demonstrably safe sector. It's proven that safety in over 60 years of use, both from the absence of accidents, lower consequences of the accidents when they occur, and particularly the direct prevention of harm through the elimination of air pollution. Really, it's a wonderful track record. Now, the safety is achieved in nuclear power today through a combination of the inherent characteristics of nuclear technology compared with other energy sources, as well as strong regulations, as well as a very strong safety culture, all of which is going to remain very, very important. So when asking, are small modular reactors, are advanced reactors safer? I would say that that is arguably missing the point. In the same way that an unaffordable technology would be pointless, a diminished safety case in technologies that are designed for the 21st century is frankly inconceivable. So the emphasis we see on these new designs might be called safer, but I think is more accurately called safety achieved more simply. And that is also more cost effective. Those two drivers, the cost effectiveness of the innovations and the safety case of the innovations, interact really very, very strongly. But the how, again, crucially, it varies. So across the designs that are advancing today, we see variations in the type of fuel, in the type of coolant, in the type of moderator or the absence of a moderator. We see differences in power density. We see differences in the enrichment based on its particular combination of these characteristics. Each one that I've looked at in any degree of detail has an outstanding safety case based on its chosen combination to achieve safety more simply. And each of them is really different. So again, generalizations don't work all that well in this space. A graphite moderator was one of the contributors to the Chernobyl accident in combination with a lot of other things. But a graphite moderator result is being used in an advanced nuclear reactor with an outstanding safety case. You know, one reactor in development is using a liquid fuel. Another is using a silicon carbide ceramic encapsulating highly robust fuel particles. So these two fuels are as different as they could possibly be. One is designed to operate in a molten form. The other is fundamentally impossible to melt, ever. Each of them, with their characteristics, is integral to the overall safety case. And in each case, the safety case, from my analysis, is very, very strong. Generalizations about the how and the why of the safety case of SMRs won't take you very far. But the commonality that you will see is that greater use of non-engineered, passive and inherent processes. So this moves towards the assurance of safe operations. For example, through the elimination of the possibility of any overpower event, through the management of decay heat all the way through to cold shutdown with no reliance on any external power sources, no reliance on any human intervention. This is the trend that is common. The how for delivery really varies. So in my opinion, there's something to be really interested in here for Australia. Fit for purpose technologies that are designed for affordability, designed for scale, designed for flexibility, that meet the safety expectation more simply. Products for off-grid and on, for heat and for power. I think there's really something to be interested in here. But I began by saying nuclear innovation and development is hard. And I think it's important to emphasize that that hard work is certainly not over yet. I am confident that these products are going to reach the market. That is not the same as this class of technologies reaching their full potential. In my opinion, that full potential is vast. Technologies of all kinds only really thrive in what I would describe as prepared and supportive contexts. Many excellent technologies are delivering less than their potential benefit because the world around them wasn't or still isn't ready. The Right Honourable Most Excellent Helen Cook, she highlighted that small modular reactor isn't really a description of a technology so much as it's a description of a business model. That business model is factory-based repetition, manufacturing, high volumes, consistency.
We should be cognizant that that business model can still be strangled. We currently see in SMR
a large-ish number of developers and vendors, very low production volumes, basically zero, and quite a diverse regulatory environment worldwide. Now, that diverse regulatory environment has plenty of potential to erode the business model, enforcing design changes for specific markets that offer little or nothing to the overall safety case, or in some cases, might actually make the safety case lesser for a particular design. What's really needed is the inverse of this. We need a somewhat rationalized number of products, very large production volumes, and we really will benefit from highly consistent regulatory treatment. An example of this is that one developer saying, well, we can give you a very detailed cost estimate, but it is for our regulatory requirements, the context in which they were confident that they would first be deploying. What are yours, was the question. Now, in Australia right now, we don't know because they don't exist. That's a risk to Australia because even if the perfect commercial product is leaving factories, we can't deploy it without establishing all of that supportive context first. Now, as I will discuss, that is also potentially an opportunity for Australia. Helen's work with Estonia, which is actively preparing itself to embrace SMR technology, highlighted that while an internationally harmonized regulatory setting for SMR would be highly desirable, it's frankly very difficult to achieve and unlikely if led through the very large established countries in nuclear power with very long legacies of operation and leasing. That it might actually be more likely that newcomer nations, using their blank sheets, could devise new fit-for-purpose regulation for this new fit-for-purpose class of technologies. So the opportunity in this potentially comes from forming a regulatory block for harmonised regulations that benefit those nations. Australia has some interesting pedigree in this through the Cairns Group. Australia formed a block of like-minded countries to contest the larger trade organisations around agriculture, the USA and the EU, comprised 19 nations from all over the world and proved highly effective in negotiations for genuine free and fair trade agriculture. Maybe something similar is required, because if we put together a number of newcomer nations that are moving towards nuclear, we can quickly establish a block of consumers of 500 million to 750 million people or more. For an SMR manufacturer, to know that their identical module will receive identical regulatory approval in each nation, it would help to activate the SMR business model to its fullest potential. There's a very good blog written recently by Ted Nordhaus about whether or not the NRC, the United States Nuclear Regulatory Commission, can reform itself. It's a relatively quick read, but a terrific context setter on this challenge. And we need to think about our regulations, certainly that are not permissive. That is not the right way to approach regulations. We can't regulate an industry to no progress. That's not regulating an industry, that's killing an industry. So we need to activate the business model successfully with fit-for-purpose regulations around fit-for-purpose technologies. If, say, we were able to put together a block of 750 million people from newcomer countries around the world who really have similar needs for fit-for-purpose technologies, there's another potential benefit here for Australia, which is that there really is a wide open place still remaining to manufacture the units. We have sort of missed the boat on manufacturing solar. We've missed the boat on manufacturing wind. There is still a window to manufacture, and if we had a large role in setting the regulatory context that would position us well to manufacture and sell it. In the net zero future, we have such an extraordinary quantity of root energy that we're going to need to provide. The power sector, which takes up the lion's share of our attention today, is one thing, but moving to decarbonize industry and transport, really getting off all fossil fuels altogether, means rather than benefiting from hundreds of millions of years of slow chemistry that nature has done for us to make a nearly finished hydrocarbon product, we're going to have to do the most amazingly large-scale effort of real-time chemistry in order to make simultaneously the volume of power and heat of electricity, synthetic fuels, hydrogen, etc. That's a huge, huge challenge. If we remove SMRs, we really slice the heart out of it. Achieving this extent of decarbonisation with renewables alone is incredibly daunting and thankfully not necessary. These technologies have the potential to be great benefit multipliers. Nations need to decide whether to position for these benefits in good time. The pipeline for fit-for-purpose nuclear is looking much stronger. The potential benefits to a net zero system are many. The technology that's involved is diverse, and each offering needs to be considered on its characteristics and its merits. An affordable product is the goal, and that does need to be proven. We can look forward to
the expectation of safety being met more simply and more affordably.
But it needs a supportive context, especially expressed through regulations. Finally, leadership in that setting could confer substantial advantages. That opportunity is open to Australia as a newcomer nation if we pursue it.
How has this discussion paper been received?
From what I can see, very well. Lots of sharing, lots of positivity around quality of the work, the quality of its presentation. To the best of my knowledge, really good. We've seen it beginning to be referred to by various other stakeholders.
That's fantastic.
Focuses on three main SMR designs. According to the WNA, in one place it says there's at least 50 different designs of SMRs under consideration. Why these three particular designs?
The 50 plus number needs to be taken with a little bit of caution. You know, there's a database of these reactors published by the IAEA with a really broad envelope of level of readiness. We were looking to highlight designs demonstrably along the way. Probably the particular hallmark we were looking for was formal engagement with Tier 1 licensing agencies. We were looking for a little bit of diversity if we could get it, so it was certainly helpful that a molten salt reactor is at that point. We were interested in achieving some diversity of size of units. We have that a little bit more interested in profiling a smaller number, a little more detail that had greater confidence rather than going very big and broad.
Do you just want to briefly mention what the three designs are and sure. what a tier one regulatory agency is?
You know, we're interested in the well-established regulatory agencies, Canadian Nuclear Safety Corporation, the United States Nuclear Regulatory Agency, the Generic Design Review for the United Kingdom's regulator.
Regulatory agencies with established reputation and footprint and processes that are going to be well-recognised and appreciated in Australia. So we looked at the NuScale power module, which is 77 megawatt module to be constructed in banks of up to 12. We looked at the BWRX 300, that's a 300 megawatt light water reactor downsized from the economic simplified boiling water reactor. We looked at the Terrestrial Energy Integral Molten Salt Reactor, that's 195 megawatts electric to be delivered in two units, so about 390 as a power project, as it says, molten salt reactor, higher temperatures. So we have a little bit of diversity there. We have two nuclear-only companies, so you know, NuScale Power, Terrestrial Energy, 100% focused on their nuclear products. That's all they do. General Electric, Hitachi, obviously, is a much larger, broader company. There's a little bit of product diversity in that, a little bit of size diversity. Two light water reactors, one molten salt reactor.
The CSIRO GenCost report does have some numbers for the cost of SMRs in it. Do you think there will have to be an SMR project built before these numbers in the GenCost report are updated?
Over the course of a few years, I've tried quite hard to engage with that process and the nature of evidence behind the costings. The process hasn't expressed
an interest in looking at evidence from high quality studies. It hasn't expressed an interest in accepting estimates, regardless of quality or the class of the estimate. And we can't really trace back the sort of root assumption of cost. To that extent, I don't really think that the GenCost work is offering much insight at all on this class of technology. That's unfortunate. My recent suggestion to them was probably just stop, just leave it out. If it's not going to be attended to with some resource, this is probably not adding any light. Yes, that might be the trigger for them to change their numbers, but that's really up to that process.
People in nuclear, such as myself, would love to start to see SMRs being constructed and built so that we can narrow down yep. and get a better estimation of the price and what it might cost in Australia.
The reasons for all three of those vendors to be profiled is that they have defined projects for which they are aiming for. Ontario Power Generation have committed development and a site that's licensed and preparation has begun on the site for a small modular reactor, which is going to be one of three designs that they're down selecting. We can look forward to some much higher resolution cost estimates in coming years based around an intention to build. That's terrific. So we'll start to see some of that evidence coming through. But again, you know, the full expression of that cost model is going to come from a full order book and a factory that's able to deliver modules. So it's a difficult innovation road. I do want to make that clear.
What is Australia currently doing in the SMR world to assist in the development and commercialization of SMRs?
It's not zero. You know, Australia is a participant in the Generation 4 International Forum, represented by ANSTO, Dr. Mark Ho, who is a representative to that forum. We will be making research contributions.
We have commenced, I understand, a cooperative research project with the International Atomic Energy Agency.
Relating to very much the
topic here, small modular reactors
in the Australian context. So
to examine in a lot more fidelity than I've been able to with this project, some of these questions of cost, applicability, fit, et cetera, et cetera. So there are processes underway, early days on that cooperative research project at the minute, I understand. Watching brief is formal expression that's used in Australia's Energy White Paper and SMR. I think that's probably not sufficient anymore. There's more than enough in this that we should be moving towards roadmap and from roadmap to action plan. It isn't sufficient to wait until everything else is perfect everywhere else and then say, thanks, I'll have five. A country needs to prepare. It's an uplifting capability and we should be looking at that a little sooner. So there are a few things happening, but from, I guess, a governmental policy level, I don't believe we're undertaking any formal work on it.
Is there work that we could be doing now to prepare for a potential future SMR?
For sure. I mean, there's nothing stopping any country from entering the IAEA Milestones Project, taking on nuclear power. You know, slight diversion, but Africa publishing a list of 15 to 20 countries on the African continent at various stages of moving through this process. In a few fora now, I've had Australian stakeholders express surprise about that and being a little taken aback. And I'm pleased to pass that on. There are hundreds of millions of people in these countries here, and particularly with mining economies, who can activate a lot of labor, young populations, who are looking at moving ahead of us in our technological capabilities with power. Perhaps slightly arrogant of us here in Australia to imagine that that wouldn't be the case. Ghana, Nigeria, Rwanda, Zambia, these countries are going through the IAEA milestones process. Now, any country can go straight to milestone one, which is a decision to make an informed commitment to nuclear power. The fact that we have legislative prohibitions does not prevent us from participating in that milestone process. It probably prevents us from going further, but we can engage with that.
It is true that the actual legislative change itself could be made quickly.
Establishing a commitment to get that done seems to be the hard part, but we could do that. There is a lot of preparatory work that could be done while those legislative prohibitions, in fact, remain in place. People might ask why, but we could be doing it if we wanted to.
Australia's talent pool. Have any thoughts on how Australia could train or recruit human capital needed?
It is not the insurmountable obstacle that it is sometimes positioned as. If you take a nuclear power facility workforce, a portion of the workforce will be specifically qualified as reactor operators managing the core reactivity in the control room. Most of the rest of it looks like a power plant in every other respect. The vast majority of jobs are quite directly transferable or highly transferable or small level of training. On the other hand, yes, we'd need reactor operators. We would need greater institutional capability in regulation to step up our waste management and disposal capabilities. We would need more radiation-related experts. So it is good that we have our nuclear engineering masters, ANU and UNSW, up and running from recent years beginning to grow. There is a good talent pool out there. We could certainly recruit a few from Germany immediately, from the United States and other places where nuclear fortunes have suffered. It would be part of the roadmap and part of the planning to have a successfully operated nuclear power sector would be to address skills. The United Arab Emirates moved from policy commitment in about 07 to power in 2021. There was a bit of a lag actually in the operations because the plant was actually built and ready to go just a little ahead of the human resources. But this was a country with no pedigree in nuclear science and technology at all.
The University of New South Wales has a number of scholarships available for their nuclear engineering master's course at the moment. Anyone who might be interested, I'll point you in the direction of Dr. Ed Obard and the University of New South Wales. I have a question here on affordability. How many years do you think from completion of a foreign first of a kind to achievement at a local nth of a kind?
Another common refrain from developers was, we've got a huge queue of people that are ready to go second. There's a lot of confidence that order books are going to fill, factories are going to get built quite quickly following someone else's commitment to go first and fundamentally de-risk that first of a kind. Maybe that's sort of 5 years after that first of a kind, starting to hit that nth of a kind target, but that's pretty loose. I wouldn't want to commit to that. I could be out by 10 years there. So it's 15 years after that. That is still going to be relevant. That is going to be relevant. The challenge that Australia has for net zero is massive, and it is massively bigger than is broadly appreciated today. All of the decarbonisation needs to occur in the economy and then be maintained forever. At no point in the future of the world can I foresee that nuclear technology isn't going to be invested in and built for our power system. It is.
Comment that with regard to attracting talent, Australia is an attractive place to work. And this has come from somebody who came to Australia to work in nuclear. So
Yeah, it is. And we have a lot of expats from the United Kingdom living in Australia quite happily. We have some very good nuclear qualified people in Australia with Frazer-Nash. Yes, it is. It is an attractive destination, desirable place to be.
Do you think the recent announcements around subs has changed the attitudes to civil nuclear energy in Australia?
Yes, it has. My experience of that was to sit back and watch. It seems that the overall
tenor of the Australian
people to this, it has been pretty much a shrug of the shoulders.
Well, yeah.
You're going to push a big boat around the ocean all day long. That's probably a good idea, right? Like Aussies are kind of pragmatic like that. And so I haven't really detected any shock horror splitting atoms to do stuff. Look, if we're talking about technology to do a job and it's the right technology for this job, really what's the difference? You know, it moves the conversation even more towards, look, if it's affordable and if private investors will build it, whatevs. Recent polling suggests I'm right, including something like 2 in 5 people who identify as voters for the Australian Greens.
Domestic uranium enrichment to ensure energy security.
Highly unlikely, and if so, not for a long time. Presently, there's lots of capacity in the market for enrichment. Those who have the existing capacity would expand their capacity.
It is a particularly tightly controlled, high barrier to entry part of the nuclear fuel cycle for extremely good reasons.
It doesn't really change our economic fortunes if we enrich our own uranium. That's a bit of a misunderstanding. A lot of the value
in the uranium
is from the yellow cake, which we mine and export. The conversion, the enrichment, the fabrication, these are slimmer pieces of the overall value, and the purchase of enriched fabricated
fuel rods
or some other sort of fuel form is a very small portion of the overall costs. It's a very small portion of the electricity costs. I suspect Australia would just become a customer of that value-added product.
I think it
would be quite a long way in the future before we decided to move towards those other bits of the fuel cycle, just because I don't see heaps of benefit for us. By contrast, the manufacture of modules of small modular reactors is not being done. That is not sort of settled and decided upon. It's a potentially very, very large global market where Australia in the style of manufacturing potentially has some really strong advantages. That's something that I could see Australia doing in future.
Do you think there's any benefits of using thorium rather than uranium as a fuel source? And do you know if any of the SMR designs are looking at thorium as opposed to uranium?
Not particularly. So I'm going to upset a few people there. No, not really.
Look, every thorium reactor is a uranium reactor at the end of the day because the uranium needs to be converted into a form of uranium in order to operate. Benefits of thorium, it's more plentiful. Why is it more plentiful? Because it's more stable. And since it's more stable, it's a little harder to use it as fuel. So science and engineering is always the world of trade-offs.
I understand the fuel cycle doesn't have any plutonium output at the end.
That's sort of an advantage, but I don't think that that's the killer disadvantage that's holding back the uranium fuel cycle presently.
What is much more important than choice of mineral are the advantages of the reactor designs and the different fuel cycles, which are broadly available to the uranium fuel cycle as well.
So be it a molten salt reactor and its advantages, be it a pebble bed reactor and its advantages, or the fuel cell carbide, be it a fast reactor like Oklo is doing.
Incredible advantages in design of reactor and design of fuel and fuel choices that aren't actually driven by
thorium, they're driven by the physics and the engineering. Are some developers looking at it? Yep, sure they are. Uranium isn't scarce though. There's lots of uranium.
There's always been lots of uranium.
So I don't know that the drivers are particularly huge. Something that has come to me from many of the innovators, we aren't trying to make something perfect. We're trying to make something affordable that will sell in really, really large numbers. You know, and those are the devices and the designs that I believe are going to succeed. They're the people that know when to stop innovating.
I don't really see that thorium is a game-changing issue in nuclear.
UK is strongly supporting the Rolls-Royce SMR at the moment, and the Australia-UK cooperation seems to be increasing on clean energy technologies, so this might be something to watch in future.
You know, the United Kingdom would be in a position currently overly exposed on natural gas. That has to change, both from a net zero perspective and from a sovereignty and an economic security perspective. It's good that they've had a nuclear restart, but they moved from a less sovereign model to a more sort of globally commercial model. They might now be looking at going, well, who are we? We're a medium-sized country that does know how to do nuclear. Maybe our best call is to be sovereign. Our best call is to take a domestic brand, back it, and have a program for Britain. I can see that being quite logical for the UK. I think Australia is probably more likely to want a commercial tender process in the manner of the UAE, where we would set the regulatory context, let the market bring projects to Australia. I don't think that we're going to go and design our new SMR. Whether Rolls-Royce and with the cooperation of the UK and maybe copying some of the regulatory frameworks could make it particularly good context for that product, that's a different question. That might be sensible. That might be sensible to make a really strong context for that product.
SMRs is usually defined as anything less than about 300 megawatts electric. I think that's the IAEA's definition. Designs you look at in your paper are quite large. So what about the really small nuclear, off-grid applications, et cetera?
It's really relevant for Australia. And there's a whole class there that I think is more accurately called micro, where you're talking about 1.5 megawatts or 5 megawatt that are generally made with really low power densities
and really large fuel loads at the beginning. So they run soft and they run long.
So, you know, 20 years or 40 years of continuous operations. Got huge scope globally, underappreciated how much power out there is currently diesel, which is both very expensive and quite dirty. And so for exploration, longer term mining or just off-grid settlements, there's actually really, really huge scope for micro modular reactors as well. The Ultra Safe Nuclear Corporation micro modular reactor engaged in licensing in Canada. It has a commitment to have the first one built by Ontario Power Generation. Site preparation has started. That's looking for first power in about 2026.
I think Australia needs to look really seriously at the fact that competing nations with resources-based economies, Canada is an excellent example, but many African nations as well, are likely to be positioned to bring 5 megawatts of clean, reliable power all the way to the mine head, all the way to communities and decarbonise them in one fell swoop. Highly relevant in the Australian context, and hopefully we get to cover that in more detail in another edition.
Could Australia follow the Tallinn model?
Yes. I would probably like to see Australia collaborate in such a model. with the likes of Estonia, say we've got a lot in common, we're pursuing the same thing, potentially draw a bit of a line in the sand and say, we want to adopt this. How can we all benefit from walking this road together?
Which countries do you think will be the SMR leaders in deployment? Who should we be watching?
Canada.
Canada?
Yep.
That's my thought as well. I always point to Canada.
Roadmap to action plan, evidence-based regulator rather than a prescriptive regulator, some Indigenous developers engaging their First Nations people in the process, signing up MOUs across the provinces, very, very active space.
Anybody else? Just Canada.
That stands out for me. I mean, I think the United States is very active as well, but sort of has a bit of a tougher regulatory reform road ahead of it. UK will be strong if it decides to go down that sovereign path. China is doing this, but still has a very large nuclear reactor program just to meet its own needs for a very long time to come, not necessarily as a major exporter. Russia similarly doing very well on large nuclear reactors worldwide where those are still the fit for purpose product. So I think Canada really stands out here.
Dr. Ben Hur, thank you so much for your time today. Do you have any last comments?
My main point would be I've gone from being
concerned about whether certain technologies are going to come.
I'm now pretty sanguine about that.
I think it is now
a much more straightforward conversation for Australia to have with itself.
It will happen.
Do we want to be involved in it and how? Do we want to be involved in it early, prompt?
And maximise benefits? Or do we want to be technology takers later?
But thank you very much for having me and thanks for your attention, everybody.